Hey everyone, welcome back. So this video is going to be not the easiest video to make because it's going to talk about maybe some difficult things that us as members and the church itself is like has problematic things in its past that we don't talk about too much in church. You know, once a year we'll touch on our kind of painful past with like blacks and the priesthood, but it's not something we usually go into. And even if you do go into an institute class, it's not something they talk about, even the cultural aspects of what happened. I want to do a somewhat quick overview on how the church and its members and civil rights and the black community and its history. The purpose of this is not to accuse church members or members of the church that lived back then that might have had like racist or discriminatory or biases. It's to highlight our history and talk about it. Most members today are on board with the idea of civil rights and treating everyone with equality and with respect, but I think it's important for us to see how we got here and how a lot of the events that are happening today echo. And as a church today, how we got to where we are today when it comes to blacks and the black community and doctrinal things that haven't spread throughout the church and people still like believe them. So firstly, we'll start with Joseph Smith. Joseph Smith, he initially, the common narrative is that he was against slavery, which is for the most part true. Initially he wasn't, especially because there was a lot of members in Missouri that had slaves. So it was one of those issues where he didn't want to push it too much because so many of the members from Missouri were slave owners and they were converting. So initially he wasn't against slavery initially. Once he started running for president, and one of the big things on his platform was against slavery. And till his death, he did run on that. And there were even black members that were ordained to the priesthood. The most famous one is Elijah Abel. He was a 70. He served a mission in the church. However, once Brigham Young took over, there was a ban on the priesthood and black members. And what is unfortunate also, what happened during this time, is that many theories start propping up about why this policy took place in the church. There's a couple that are very popular, and I even hear them today, and even as a missionary, I heard them as when I taught members of the church or converts. It's very widespread. The church has disavowed and does not stand by any of these doctrines or these theories of doctrine. The two main ones are that, firstly, the reason why blacks weren't able to receive the priesthood or ordinances was because they were descendant of Cain and they were marked. And they were marked with dark skin, and due to that, they were had to serve, you know, their brother because of sin that passed on through history. And if you go into the Book of Mormon, there are various scriptures that say that the Lamanites were also cursed with dark skin. And once again, the doctrine was, and some people still to this day say that was because they didn't want the Lamanites and the Nephites mixing and their beliefs mixing. And which is, I mean, if you want to believe that, that's fine. The only issue why I have issue with this is not because of the history in the Book of Mormon, if you want to read it that way, but the way it's understood by members. Because what does that say to members when they read that? In my opinion, that essentially is saying to a lot of members that interracial relationships and interracial marriage isn't a good thing and is looked down upon. And we'll get back to interracial marriage and relationships because that is also a big issue that happened in the church. The second doctrinal reason why some people also say why there was a ban with blacks in the priesthood was because they were not very faithful in the premortal existence. This is something I've heard many times. The idea is in the premortal existence, there were those people that were really on God's plan, very supportive of God's plan, and there were those that supported Satan's plan and they went along with him, but then there were people kind of in the middle somewhere, and those people, they were cursed with dark skin, black skin. I've heard this many times. I've been referred to as unfaithful because of my skin color in the church, and it's something that it is still popular and I still hear it today. So getting closer to the 60s and 70s and the civil rights movement, the church overall and its leaders were not big supporters of the civil rights movement. Are there outliers? There were, but overall, most of them did not support it outright. There were even many gatherings and even groups that would get together at the church, and they were figuring out on how to buy the homes around church buildings so there wouldn't be black members to attend that church. And there were many, there's countless, you can look online, there's countless accounts of black children and black members being excluded even from church activities or even like Boy Scouts because they were black. During the same time, the NAACP was pushing the church and its church leaders to make a statement or to publish a statement on civil rights and its support of civil rights. The NAACP had issues, especially because there was that ban on the priesthood and just these practices, like anti-racial practices that were going on in Utah at the time that I talked about a little bit. The 1963 General Conference was coming up, and they spoke with church leaders, and they said that they were going to protest outside of the General Conference that day if the church didn't release a statement about civil rights. Under that pressure, the church did read a statement. It wasn't an official statement, but there was a statement read as part of a speech during General Conference that year. And there was no protest because of that. The NAACP, 2 years later in 1965, asked the church to publish a statement. And the church initially said they were going to publish it in the Deseret News. However, they did not, and due to that, the NAACP did protest that year. And due to that protest, the church did eventually publish a statement on civil rights on the Deseret News. And as we know, it wasn't until 1978 that the church lifted the ban on the blacks and the priesthood. However, during that same day, a statement from the church still discourage interracial marriage the same day. And one of the stories that I probably found probably the saddest out of so many stories that I read was one that had to do with BYU football and BYU sports. In 1968, BYU played the University of Wyoming, which was largely consisted of black players. BYU lost that game. And instead of following tradition and handshaking the other team after the game, the BYU players did not. They refused to handshake the University of Wyoming players. Instead, they went back to their locker rooms and they turned on the sprinklers on the University of Wyoming team, soaking them in the field. The University of Wyoming players then went back to their locker rooms, and when they got there, they found racist caricatures of a black man and a monkey that were graffitied there in their locker room. The next day, in a local newspaper that was covering the game, stated on their headline that BYU cleansed the field of evil that day. And to head back a little bit on interracial marriage and interracial relationships, the church has been somewhat discouraging of that for the longest time. Even in 1977, Boy K. Packer, he, in one of his talks, he said that Mexicans should marry Mexicans, Japanese should marry Japanese, Caucasians should marry Caucasians, and Polynesians should marry Polynesians. He said there are exceptions, but he didn't feel that everyone should be an exception. And there are statements like these that were included against the idea of interracial marriage and interracial relationships, even institute books and like marriage books, as recently as the 2000s. In 2018, the church did a special like celebration commemorating the 1978 lift on the ban on blacks in the priesthood. And what they did was that it was just in the conference center in downtown. They talked about like black leaders in church history. They had a lot of black singers and musicians that were playing. And they talked about the long road it took them to get to the 1978 declaration of unbanning blacks in the priesthood. I went to that celebration and there were a lot of black families there, a lot of black members there. And something I did notice while I was there was I noticed that this was like the first time the church in a very open setting was talking about its history. And it was very emotional. I saw so many black families were just crying. And they were crying, I think, because there's just so much pain. There's just so much pain associated with our church, race, and discrimination. There's just so much pain and so much things that have not been said. And this was the most public forum that the church, in my opinion, I've seen, where it was kind of almost a formal apology. And it meant a lot to those members when I was there. And browsing through social media and the news, I still see that we are, as Americans, we are still on that journey fighting for respect and dignity for one another. And the reason why I want to pinpoint some of these points of the church and its history is to highlight that members, black members of the church, have been fighting for this, have been fighting for equal rights, have been fighting for respect, have been fighting for dignity for decades, for so many years. This isn't something new. And for the most part, they were ignored. They were silenced. They wouldn't get what they wanted unless they protested. And as I stated before, a lot of times they had to protest so they can push leaders of the church to make a statement, to publish something, to as support that of civil rights and equality. I do feel like the protests today are echoing a lot of the protests that happened at that time. And they do want the same thing. They want to be treated with respect. And I think it's a great opportunity for members today to be able to join them in that. There weren't many that did join them during the civil rights, during Joseph Smith's time. There were some. But overall, the black community was alone to defend for themselves. And it took them so much longer by themselves. I do feel like this movement that's happening is larger than looters, larger than broken into stores. It's about having true love for one another. And I think that is the doctrine of Christ. One of my favorite scriptures in all the Book of Mormon is Mosiah 18:9, where it talks about if we want to be a light, if we want to be like disciples of God and Jesus, we have to be willing to mourn with those that mourn and comfort those that stand in need of comfort. And it's obvious that the ones who are mourning, the ones who are in need of comfort, are our black brothers and sisters. I hope this video was able to be helpful in helping you understand maybe a little bit about our history and our struggle and the pain maybe that we have experienced as members of the church, as a church itself, and how we still have a long ways to go, even not even as a church, but even as just as a country. I encourage you to share your thoughts, share your have conversations with those in your family and friends who might not be as open, who might be struggling with these concepts, who might be struggling with these issues within themselves. I think just good conversation can definitely help people recognize their biases. Let me hear your thoughts. Feel free to comment and share this video if you like. And we'll talk again next week. Bye.